27. हाँ तब तो गए, कभी कभी तो गए, जाते थे वो।
You have all the details, no? Good afternoon to all. And welcome to this JSS session again about COVID. So this session is dedicated to JIPMA's effort in the management and containment of COVID. And because of the extensive experience in terms of patient number, guidelines, and other management strategies, we are in a position to produce scientific output out of our COVID experience. So first of all, I thank all the departments who contributed in the form of abstract to make this a wonderful program. And from our JSS side, we also request all of you to produce these abstracts in the form of manuscript and publications in future, by adding more experience and more numbers, so that JIPMA name will come forever in the management of COVID. And in the JIPMA studio, along with me, Dr. Mamta, secretary, is there. And I'll hand over to Dr. Mamta to invite the abstract presenters.
We are starting the meeting with the presentation of original studies. The first presentation will be from the Department of Medical Oncology, and they are going to present on clinical characteristics.
Dr. Riju, can you hear me?
Yes.
Clinical characteristics and outcomes of COVID-19 infected cancer patients, a retrospective case study. I invite the presenter from Medical Oncology to do the presentation and start presenting.
Hello.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes, I'll start sharing now.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can you see the screen? Go ahead.
Yeah, we are seeing the slides, and please make it in full screen.
Sure.
It's yeah, perfect. Please keep your time and please go ahead.
Yes, sir. A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm Dr. Sindhu from Department of Medical Oncology. I'll be presenting clinical characteristics and outcomes of cancer patients with COVID-19. Before I begin, I would like to thank all the departments involved in COVID care in our hospital. As we all know, cancer care itself is multidisciplinary and involves synchronized efforts from various departments, including medical oncology, radiation, surgical oncology, medicine, pediatrics, obstetrics, orthopedics, and almost all the departments. And similarly, we have seen in the last few months that COVID care similarly involves all the healthcare workers, right from the doctors, nurses, the other staff like DRLs, SMPs, the IT personnel, etc., to help patients overcome these trying times. And I really thank all of you for making tremendous efforts during these trying times. So the entire COVID task force, as well as the JIPMA family, thank you. I'm not able to move the slides, sir. Yeah. So coming to the background of my study, cancer patients, as we know, are highly vulnerable to various infectious complications because of the decreased immune function, both due to the cancer as well as its treatment, which is often immunosuppressive. And in the current COVID-19 pandemic, we have limited data from India on the outcomes of COVID-19 in patients with cancer. However, there are multiple studies from China, US, UK that suggest that COVID-19 infected cancer patients have higher mortality rates ranging from 13% to 30%. But many of these studies have methodological flaws because mostly are retrospective. The initial studies are small in numbers and all the data has to be taken with a pinch of salt. So until and unless we have more robust prospective trials, we need to do the treatment and modification as per the local experience. Coming to patients and methods, it's a retrospective study. We included all the cancer patients with the COVID-19 diagnosis seen in our department from April 30th, where we saw the first index case, till September 4th. And data was collected from medical records as well as teleconsultation records. So just to give a perspective, between May to August, we saw a rise in cases in Pondicherry. The blue is Pondicherry. And then similarly, increase in number of cases at Jipmer, which is shown in the orange. And what we saw in RCC in April was the first case. May, June, there were no cases. Then July, we had 4. August, we saw 20, and we have one case in September now. Coming to the number of cancer patients we saw, so May, June, we saw around 1,500 cases roughly, and July 1,800, as we were not seeing any COVID patients initially, we started the, initially we had stopped treatments or interrupted during the months of April, May, and then slowly restarted. But as the COVID numbers increased, we decreased the number of OPD patients and IPD. And here we see in August, we saw almost 20 patients, cancer patients. And this is not to show that it is decreasing. We still have to see the data of September, but hopefully we'll see this trend in the next 4 to 5 months. Coming to the baseline patient characteristics, the age distribution was 6 months to 65 years with a median age of 29 years. By the deciles, if you see, we had almost a quarter of patients in the pediatric age group, 0 to 9 years, then a quarter in the adolescent, 20 to 29 years, and 50 to 59 years. So this is in contrast to the various other studies where there's more of elderly population. And this is because of the bias of case selection at our department, where we have chosen to treat pediatric curative intent, leukemia, and other such patients. Coming to the sex distribution, around 60% were male and 40% female. The comorbidities, again, lesser percent compared to the other studies, around 20% diabetes and 15% hypertension because of less number of older patients. And another interesting thing is most of the cancer patients have some baseline lung involvement either because of disease or because of infection during the treatment or because of cancer itself. So we had almost a third of patients with baseline lung involvement, out of which four patients it was because of cancer. One was a metastatic lung disease, a couple of them T lymphoblastic lymphomas where you have a mediastinal mass with lung involvement. Another patient with multiple myeloma involving the pleura. And then we had another four patients who had some baseline infection at the time of before COVID diagnosis. Then coming to the types of cancer, again, we saw a lot of hematological malignancies, as I discussed before, ALLs, AMLs, and a good number of multiple myeloma, four patients, which is usually in the elderly, and fewer number of solid tumors, one each of lung, gastric, breast cancer, oral cavity, and sarcoma. Then coming to the cancer status, around 60% of the patients had active cancer. What I mean by active cancer is either leukemia patients who were in the induction phase where disease was not in remission yet, or solid tumors who were on neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And around 40% of the patients who had cancer under control, that is those on adjuvant therapies or those on consolidation and maintenance treatments. The intent of cancer therapy, again, a large proportion was curative intent because of the selected population. One patient was not fit for starting treatment, a newly diagnosed elderly ALL patient. And another patient, one was a metastatic lung with palliative intent treatment and another a recurrent sarcoma. Coming to symptoms and signs at presentation, almost half the patients had presented with fever. Again, this is a big diagnostic dilemma for us because most of our patients present with febrile neutropenias or at diagnosis, leukemia is present with fever as one of the symptoms. So it's very difficult to differentiate just based on fever, whether it is COVID or something else happening there. And another interesting thing that we saw is 30% of the patients were asymptomatic. These are patients who were either screened before admission or patients who had positive contact history but remained asymptomatic. So around three patients were found to have a contact with a known COVID positive patient within the hospital. For the remaining patients, we couldn't really elicit data whether it was acquired from the hospital or outside in the community. Coming to imaging, chest X-ray was available for around 60% of the patients. Out of which 60% had abnormalities. And HRCT was done for a smaller number, 20%. And most of them had some ground glassing or infiltrates and other findings characteristic of COVID. Coming to the treatment of COVID, severe infection as defined by respiratory rate more than 30 or saturation less than 90% or ARDS or multi-organ dysfunction was seen in around 40% of the patients. 55% of the patients were put on systemic steroids, around 42% on low molecular weight heparin. We see the discrepancy because most of the pediatric children were not put on enoxaparin, they only received steroids. One child with suspected inflammatory syndrome due to COVID received IVIG. None of the patients received any antivirals like remdesivir. So all the patients with severe infection were on oxygen. Around 20% required ICU admission. A quarter went on to require NIV. And around 15%, that is four patients, needed the ventilation, invasive mechanical ventilation. So what happened to the cancer therapy during this time? One patient, as I discussed, was not started on therapy because of poor general condition. The first index patient of CLL did not fit the criteria for starting therapy and was kept under observation. In the majority of the patients, there was treatment interruption or modification. Interruption in around 60%, and in the remaining 40%, some sort of modified or bridging therapy was done. Like in leukemias, they were continued on steroids, but elasparginase, which is thrombotic, prothrombotic, was withheld. And some patients, steroids were also withheld when they had overthrombosis. But otherwise, some metronomic therapy was given instead of intensive IV chemotherapy. And the median duration of interruption was around 18 days with a range of 5 to 56 days. Coming to the outcomes, mortality was seen in 3 patients, that is roughly 12%. 4 patients were sent for home quarantine who were asymptomatic and otherwise stable. 16 patients totally were discharged and are doing well. The median number of days admitted was 11 days with a range of 7 to 26 days. 3 patients remain admitted with days of admission a median of 13. So severe COVID illness, as I showed before, was seen in around 40%. Out of these, 6 patients required non-invasive ventilation, 2 of whom recovered, but 4 deteriorated and went on to require invasive ventilation. One of these patients is now on tracheostomy and stable. The other 3 have expired. Out of these, one was a 7-year-old child with newly diagnosed ALL and tumor lysis syndrome. Another was a 55-year-old newly diagnosed ALL again, who was not started on treatment because of poor general condition. So these 2 patients had disease as well as COVID. So we don't know which was the contributing factor to death here. The last one was a 35-year-old lady post 4th cycle of AVD chemotherapy with disease in remission. So this was definitely a death due to COVID. And we have repeat swabs in around 9 patients, that is 35%. So repeat swabs are negative in around 55% of the patients, and the median time to negativity was 16 days. Range of 11 to 24 days. The ICMR data and other studies show a time to negativity for general population of around 10 days. And some studies show that in cancer patients, the clearance is seen as late as even 4 weeks. But this is also seen in some normal patients. Around 4 patients remain positive at a range of 10 to 26 days from the start of from the initial COVID diagnosis. So all patients eventually are planned to be restarted on anti-cancer therapy after the quarantine period. And around a quarter of the patients have already been started on therapy. Comparing our results with other data, one of the studies from China shows higher mortality rates. But you can see that they had more of lung cancer and elderly patients, probably that's why. And other data from UK, London, and from a group study, including US, Canada, and Spain, they also show a higher mortality rate of around 30%, probably because elderly population and more number of patients on palliative intent treatment, where you can't really distinguish between COVID versus cancer deaths. Another study from Spain reported a mortality rate of around 13%, which is somewhat similar to our study, but our numbers are too small to make any final conclusions. As we already discussed, the median age is lesser in our study because of the patient selection, mostly hematological malignancies and hence curative intent treatment. So we need further studies to substantiate the impact of COVID on cancer, how it affects outcomes in cancer patients, and how treatment interruption affects the outcome eventually. The limitations of our study is that we included only patients who are referred or seen at Department of Medical Oncology. The other cancer patients admitted elsewhere and not referred to us, or newly diagnosed patients who had come to the hospital have not been included. It's a retrospective analysis. Concluding, in this preliminary analysis, we have identified higher complication rates in cancer patients with COVID than what we expect in the general population without comorbidities. Hence, extreme caution is required to make sure these patients don't acquire the infection. The cancer treatment interruption may eventually affect the outcome of these patients. So this has to be studied with further follow-up. Thank you all. I again would like to acknowledge everybody, all the healthcare workers, for putting a tremendous effort and helping us all in these difficult times. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for the presentation. And probably this will be our first experience oncology and COVID. And I have one question. You mentioned that
yes.
You are doing a quarantine, observing quarantine period as well as testing. Am I correct? You need a negative test to start the anti-cancer therapy again. Am I correct?
So, sir, for all the patients, we did not get a second test done. A lot of patients are still in the quarantine period. For all those who we have started on therapy, we have a negative test. But we are yet to...
So the question is, did you start therapy without a negative test?
Not yet, sir. Not for any patient.
Okay. I think that becomes mandatory. Any other questions from any of the participants? Any questions from other faculty or residents?
Interestingly, can I ask, Biju, can you hear me?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sindhu, interestingly, yes. I don't find any patients of gynae oncology. Is it because they have stopped coming or is it because they have not taken them at all, especially ovarian tumors who would be even in 40s, 50s?
Yes, ma'am. Probably just selection bias.
Mm-hmm.
We were mostly seeing curative intent cancers. We have treated some neoadjuvant ovaries also during this period, but we didn't have any case of ovarian cancer having COVID, ma'am.
I have a question.
Yes.
Can we really say that we have to follow these patients to PCR negativity before restarting treatment? For most of the acute infections, we don't. Only where there is a possibility of a persistent infection,
yes,
we possibly need to do that. So I don't think this virus is still now known to cause persistent infection and hence it may not be necessary.
So we have one patient who is relatively asymptomatic now but had a tough course initially with being hypotensive and having septic shock and all that initially at the time of diagnosis of COVID. Even at around day 26, she's still positive. So we are not sure whether we should take that into consideration to start therapy because we don't know how long it will take to seroconvert in immune compromised patients.
Let me just stop you there.
Yes,
see, let's not use the word seroconvert.
Yeah,
seroconvert
sorry,
refers
sir.
To antibodies.
Yeah, that is different. Yes. Sir.
Okay. PCR is known that it remains positive
true.
Fairly frequently on day 26, even in otherwise healthy people.
True, sir.
And till now, there are no data to show that COVID is more severe in general in patients with cancer or other forms of immunosuppression.
Yes, sir.
There is no data to show that replication occurs at a faster rate.
True.
Viruses, you know, different viruses are different. CMV may be different in immunosuppressed people, but I don't think as of today we have any evidence. So I think we should treat it just whether even there is a role of stopping anti-cancer treatment, we are not sure, but that seems prudent. But following to negativity might mean that we may not give them treatment for a long time and which might be detrimental to their basic condition. I realize it is question remains open. But I don't think we can say that we have to follow them to negative. Thank you.
True, sir. There's one patient who was completely asymptomatic and we actually have admitted him now and we need to start therapy. We were discussing whether to do a repeat test or start the anti-cancer therapy already.
The transplant community is seeing that in their patients who are even more immunosuppressed, there is no increase in disease or in any other problems. Thank you.
There are no questions to Dr. Sindhu. We will move on to the next presentation. It's on perinatal transmission potential of COVID-19 infection and its fetal bar neonatal outcome, a prospective observational study done by Department of Neonatology in collaboration with Microbiology and Obstetric Gynecology. I invite Dr. Thanigai Nathan from the Department of Neonatology to start his presentation.
What's happening?
Please make it full screen. Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah. Yeah, we can see your slides. Please go ahead. Please unmute yourself. No, we can't hear you. Please unmute yourself. Please unmute. Able to hear, no? No, we can't hear you. Please unmute. If you're using headset, please use microphone option.
Am I audible, sir, now?
Yeah, you can.
You are audible now. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you.
Sir. Start from your first slide.
Yes, sir. Good evening to one and all here, and my sincere thanks to my other department who helped a lot, Department of Obstetric Gynecology and Department of Microbiology. And I thank to all the residents who took effort to collect the samples for the research purposes from Department of Neonatology and Obstetric and Gynecology. SARS-CoV-2 virus is highly infectious, we all know. Main route of spread is respiratory droplets and person-to-person contact and air. But controversy exists regarding whether SARS-CoV-2 can be transmitted in utero from an infected mother to her fetus before birth or during peripartum period. So the aim of our study is to find out the possibility of perinatal transmission of novel coronavirus 19 from infected mother to fetus or neonate and its complications. This is a prospective observational study done in tertiary care neonatal and perinatal unit JIPMER. Study population are mothers with novel coronavirus 19 positive of throat or nasopharyngeal swab by RT-PCR and the babies born to them. The study was done in the duration of 2.5 months. Study procedure, we did RT-PCR for novel coronavirus 19 from the following samples, from the amniotic fluid samples of 15 mothers and vaginal secretions of 20 mothers and cord blood of 20 babies and breast milk samples from 30 mothers and throat and nasal swab for RT-PCR was sent from all neonates born to novel coronavirus positive mothers. And swab was sent on day two after 24 hours to 48 hours gap and on day five. And cord blood or neonatal blood, if cord blood was not able to take, within 48 hours was sent for CRP, total counts and LDH and liver enzymes to check for any perinatal transmission induced inflammations in the fetal period itself. It was planned to check anti-IgM and the IgG antibody in the cord blood and in the breast milk, but the kit is not available in it, so we stored the sample. We defined the perinatal transmission as follows. Baby born to mother within 14 days of COVID-19 positive with any of the following. Baby throat swab for COVID-19 positive on day 2 or day 5. Cord blood RT-PCR positive or cord blood anti-IgM for coronavirus 19 positive. Babies were taken care by mothers in COVID ward unless mother is sick exclusive breastfeeding was encouraged in all babies. Mothers were taught of infection prevention measures using face mask and hand hygiene. Baby and mother were discharged after the isolation period of 7 to 10 days as per JIPMER policy. So total deliveries in two and a half months was 1,320. 35% of mother undergone LSES, 65% mother undergone vaginal delivery. In that, around 6.4% mother were corona positive. Almost 50% delivery happened in SSB annex. In that, 67.5% were LSES and 32.5% were labor. And 11% delivered in CLR, then came to know the result positive for the mothers. And 36% delivered in SLR. One baby delivered in HDU and one baby delivered was delivered in eclampsia. Almost 48% delivered by spontaneous vaginal delivery and 47% delivered by cesarean section, 5% required instrumental delivery. So including outborn, we had 94 mothers who positive for the 94 mothers who positive for COVID, and babies got admitted in our JIPMER. 85 inborn and 8 were outborn, 1 readmissions and 3 twins. Baseline characters, almost 55% were male, 42.7% were female, 2% around indeterminate sex at the time of birth, and 80% were term, 18.6% were preterm, around 1% were post-term. Normal weight babies were around 74%, 22.3% were low birth weight babies, and 3% were more than 4 kg babies. So this is the RT-PCR results. From amniotic fluid, cord blood, vaginal secretions, all the samples were negative for RT-PCR. From the breast milk, we sent 30 samples. In that, 28 samples were negative. One sample on day 3 was diagnosed as positive, but next day the sample was repeated, that shows negative. And one sample was inconclusive on day 3 to day 4, then it was repeated on the next day, it became negative. So it was considered as contaminant. And neonatal throat and nasal swab on day 2, 85 babies were done, all were negative. And day 5 samples, we could able to do in 51 babies, all were negative. The samples of WBC count and CRP, LDH and LFT were sent from 20 babies, all were within normal limit. And one baby born to COVID positive mother died due to non-COVID related death. And babies were followed up till 1 month of age, all were well, no complaints on exclusive breastfeeding. So whoever completed 1 month of age were followed up, they were normal. They are normal. Serum samples for antibody and breast milk samples for antibody is stored. Previous studies shows systematic, the recent systematic review meta-analysis from the previous case series and case reports and few retrospective studies, they have combined the data and they found out of 936 neonates, 27 were positive on at birth as well as 24 to 48 hours of life. So two swab were positive. Around 3.2% of the babies, throat swab, and cord blood were positive in one baby out of 34 babies. Neonatal cord blood for IgM were positive in 3 babies out of 82 babies. Placental pathology shows positive for 2 out of 26 placental examination, and neonatal fecal and rectal sample were sent for 31. In that, 3 babies samples were positive. So this is from the various literature evidences. And amniotic fluid and neonatal urine sample were negative for RT-PCR. So this is a previous study. A case report was done regarding the presence of SARS-CoV-2 in human breast milk. So they have seen 2 babies. In that, one mother had virus in the breast milk in 2 days, from day 9 to day 10 and day 12 and day 13. So 3 samples were positive for COVID virus in the breast milk. They have reported one more baby, but that baby's mother's breast milk samples were negative for COVID virus. The mother who had positive breast milk, in that baby, simultaneously the baby's throat swab also was documented as positive after day 10, but before day 10, the one throat swab was negative, documented as negative. Then after that, day 9, the throat swab was documented as positive, and it was persisted positive in 21 days. Then it became negative on 25 day of life, when the same simultaneously the breast milk sample for day 25 also become negative. So from the literature evidences, it seems vertical transmission is possible in minority of cases, and rate of infections looks similar to other pathogens like congenital infections, which is causing congenital infections. But the evidences available were in the third trimester data. So early trimester data we don't have. So conclusion from our study, so we found that novel coronavirus 19 infection is not transmitted through vertical route from mother to baby through any route, and infant of coronavirus positive mothers can be safely nursed with mothers and can encourage exclusive breastfeeding. So previously, as the 2-3 case report documented that breast milk shows virus, but they have done RT-PCR, but it's a dead virus or it's a live virus, there was no any documentation on that. And CARD IgM positivity was noticed in previous case report for coronavirus antigen, but that antibody not persistent in the subsequent samples, which was done in the second week of the life of the baby. So it may be a false positive, because if any infection happened in the baby and produced the antibody, it should persist at least for a few months, but it was not documented in the previous case report. So there is a thought like this may be a false positive reports. The only thing is, like, few case report we have at birth and 24 to 48 hours of life, some coronavirus antigen RT-PCR positive in babies. That few case reports is published, but we didn't get any positivity in our unit. So strength of our studies, this is the only study look the all possible route, like amniotic fluid, cord blood, vaginal secretions, and breast milk for perinatal transmission of coronavirus 19. Limitation is small sample size, and the antibody test result is pending. Thank you.
Yeah, very good study with a very clear message. And I just wanted to ask you, this 48% of cesarean is expected in normal situations, or are there any specific indications?
So
Can I answer that? I don't know. Tanika should answer.
Yes, madam. You can answer, madam. You are a better person. Here.
No. This, they'll be evaluating you to answer. Otherwise, I would like to say something.
No.
Actually, the section rate is not because of the indications. Most of the time, it's either we don't see. Many a time, we may be having high-risk patients. Most of us, our patients are high-risk, and we require induction. But induction, the problem is, if she develops fetal distress, to move the patient to the COVID OT and, you know, do the things, it's taking a lot of time. So when the patients are going into active labor, we are allowing vaginal delivery. But where they need induction and there's a risk of fetal distress, we are doing section. So maybe slowly we will change the stages, mainly because of logistic thing. And world over, it's the same way of management. We are avoiding inductions. That is one thing. So that's the reason why section rates are not only in COVID positive, even the non-COVID areas, our section rates have gone up right now because our delivery rates have come down, plus we are managing only high-risk patients. What Tanika Nadin presented, 1,300 deliveries, is over 2.5 months. Normally, it's our usual one-month story. So that's what I wanted to say. And one more thing, Tanika, I wanted to know.
Yes, sir.
How did you collect sample for amniotic fluid? Because...
Yes, madam. Actually, it was till now, out of 85 deliveries, we could collect only from 15 mothers. It was difficult only. For normal delivery, it was not happening. Only for in cesarean sections, when the mother is stable and then they are collecting and trying to collect the time of delivery by syringe after opened the...
Yeah, that's true. Because at normal delivery, what happens is most of it's contaminated with vaginal or cervical secretions. So it will be, unless you do an amniotic fluid aspiration or something prenatally, which is not going to be very ethical, just for this.
Yes.
Thank you. Otherwise, well presented. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
Any other questions from any other participants?
Yeah, everyone here. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to know what is the time interval between the diagnosis in the mother and the time at which you evaluated the clinical samples?
Yes, sir. These are all mother delivered. So within 24 to 48 hours, all the delivery happens after diagnosing the COVID positive. So it's all within 2 to 3 days.
Within 2 to 3 days,
3 days of mother positive results.
Mother being diagnosed.
Yes.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, we will invite the last question. Any other question?
Maybe that is...
Yes, may I ask? Okay, go ahead, please. Anybody else? Yeah, go ahead.
No, sir, it's okay, sir.
Yes, sir, please go ahead.
Whosoever was there, please go ahead. You are younger, please go ahead.
Sir, it's me only, sir. You can carry on.
You are younger, right? Go ahead, please.
No, I wanted to say, to respond to Kadirwan, maybe because we are taking the samples within 2 to 3 days of delivery. That may be one reason. We don't know why we are still not got positive, but babies have not shown up any symptoms later on also. So,
yes, ma'am. Yes.
So, you know, what I wanted to say was it depends, you know, we should use our words very carefully. Perinatal, you know, we have followed them up to day 5. We cannot say that there is no perinatal transmission because we know that incubation period, at least in adults, is up to 2 weeks. So in infants, whether it is different, we don't know. So till that time, we should at least follow. Secondly, when we do an amniocentesis, remember we are using a PCR. PCR can be positive even if amniotic fluid does not have, because when we go through a tissue, just the small amount of blood that will enter the needle at that time can lead to positivity because we are using PCR. Thirdly, you know, when you get a one PCR positive and second negative, it is very difficult to say that is contamination. It becomes extremely challenging to say anything. The ideal thing is that in the same material, the first day material, we should try and do a PCR for other parts of the viral genome. That is the traditional method followed. If another part is positive, then it should really mean real positivity. If it is not, and also depends on what kind of CT value do we have. That is what I wanted to add. Finally, you know, placenta positivity has the same problem. in placenta, PCR positivity doesn't mean anything. What one has to show is by immunohistochemistry, presence of a viral antigen. PCR will of course be positive. It has so much of maternal blood. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Tanika, I wanted to ask one question.
Yes, ma'am.
Regarding the vertical transmission, we all know that trimester wise also the infection varies.
Yes,
have you come across any literature where they would have done on abortive women, aborted women in the first trimester or second trimester? Where
yes, madam. Actually, I gone through the literature. Literature actually.
Dr. Mamta, vertical yes, transmission is a very difficult concept, especially for acute infections. Very difficult to say what is vertical transmission. Even for where we talk about vertical, it is a question whether it happens at birth or after birth. Over.
Yes, madam. So I gone through the literature. It says most of the literatures we got in the late trimester only. So the first and second trimester we didn't have, but some documentation is there. But the abortion is associated with few case report, but they are not sure that that is because of COVID. So they are not able to tell the associations between the two incidents.
Yeah. We'll go to the next presentation. I also request the presenters to answer further queries in the chat box.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
We move on to the third presentation from the Department of Nephrology. It's about renal replacement therapy during the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, the JIPMER experience. I invite the presenter to please load the presentation and
can I start?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Dr. Kapil Sejpal from Department of Nephrology. Today, I'll be discussing renal replacement therapy during the COVID-19 pandemic, the JIPMER experience. The ongoing COVID-19 pandemic has posed unforeseen challenges to the healthcare system, including delivery of renal replacement therapy. And especially dialysis patients are at increased risk for COVID-19 and its complications. The COVID-19 patients with renal dysfunction requiring renal replacement therapy, we can broadly divide into three types. One is acute kidney injury, second is acute on chronic kidney disease, and third would be chronic kidney disease, that is end-stage renal disease on dialysis. Acute kidney injury is common among critically ill COVID-19 patients with estimates of 20 to 40% in the ICU settings. And it is also considered as a marker of disease severity and as a negative prognostic marker on the survival of the patients. Coming to the pathophysiology in short of AKI in COVID-19, COVID-19 can have itself has been shown to have some direct cytopathic effect on the tubular epithelial cells and the podocytes. Secondly, due to the hypercoagulability associated with the COVID-19 and the microangiopathy, these can also insult the kidneys, and also the hypoxia and hypotension in the critically ill COVID-19 patients. So various pathological manifestations has been defined in COVID-19 patients with AKI. This could be acute tubular necrosis, interstitial inflammation, podocytopathy, microangiopathy, or collapsing glomerulopathy. As far as the COVID-19 facility is concerned, we have three dialysis unit set up. First is at the second, first floor SSB Annex, which is the ICU 2. Second, we have at the third floor SSB Annex. And third, we have at the EMS fifth floor suspect ICU. This is a basically retrospective analysis, which we have gathered from hospital information system and dialysis records. The study population, we included patients with laboratory confirmed COVID-19 infection admitted in JIPMER between 1st of June and 31st of August, and our study subjects were patients in this time frame requiring renal replacement therapy. There were a total 44 patients requiring renal replacement therapy in this time frame, out of which 35, that is 80%, were males, and 9, that is 20%, were females. Coming to the age distribution, the most common age distribution age group in this patient was 41 to 60 years old, consisting of 23 patients, and 11 patients were more than 60 years of age. Coming to diagnosis of these patients, 5 patients had pure AKI out of 44 patients, 13 patients had acute on chronic kidney disease, and 26 patients were ESRD on admission. Coming to the comorbidities that these patients had, 38 patients had diabetes, had hypertension as the comorbidity, 23 patients had diabetes mellitus as the comorbidity, 2 patients had coronary artery disease, 1 patient had chronic liver disease, and 1 patient had HIV. Coming to the COVID severity, 19 patients had uncomplicated COVID-19 infection, 2 patients had mild pneumonia, 4 had severe pneumonia, 6 patients had ARDS, 3 patients had sepsis, and 10 patients had septic shock. As far as the chest radiograph of this 44 patients is concerned, 60% patients had an abnormal chest radiograph consisting of bilateral chest radiograph abnormality, and 40% patient had a normal chest radiograph. The RRT modality that we provided for this patient, 28 patients out of 44 required intermittent hemodialysis, that is IHD. 12 patients required slow, low efficiency dialysis, that is SLED. 3 patients required continuous renal replacement therapy, that is CRRT. And 3 patients were on CAPD, that is continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. One thing to note about these patients, 3 patients, is the CAPD patients were already on CAPD before admission. So we continued this CAPD exchanges in SSB Annex. They were not initiated on CAPD, but they were continued on the same modality. Coming to number of sessions in this time frame, in June, there were 23 sessions of dialysis. In July, they increased to 90. And in August, there were 120 sessions of dialysis given to these patients. Coming to the patients in ICU, out of the 44 patients that were in this study, 22 patients required ICU care and renal replacement therapy. And all these 22 patients required mechanical ventilation. Out of these 22 patients, 20 patients required anatropic support. And out of these 22, 19 patients expired in ICU. The mean duration of stay in the ICU was 5 days. Coming to the patient outcomes, out of this 44 patients, 45% expired, 20 patients, that is 45% expired, 24 patients, that is 55% recovered. If we look into the, specifically into the ESRD population, that is CKD-5D, those patients who were already on some form of dialysis before admission, we see that there were 7 patients who expired, that is 27 patients, and 73 patients, that is 19 patients recovered. These are specifically to patients of ESRD. Now coming to the patient outcome in AKI patients, 18 patients had AKI. Out of this, 72%, that is 13 patients expired, and 5 patients, that is 28% recovered. If we compare this mortality in AKI and CKD patients, the p-value was 0.005. It was mortality was significantly higher in patients with AKI as compared to CKD. If we compare the comorbidities and other factors in survivors versus non-survivors, we find that age was significantly higher in non-survivors, with the mean age of 56.85 in non-survivors and 44.17 in survivors, with a significant p-value of 0.013. Other factors like diabetes, hypertension, coronary artery disease, chronic liver disease, and HIV were not significantly different from the survivors as compared to non-survivors. If we compare the mean Charlson's comorbidity index in the non-survivors and survivors, it was 5.47 in non-survivors and 3 in survivors. Coming to discussion, in patients hospitalized with COVID-19, those with ESRD have a higher rate of in-hospital death compared to those without ESRD. And factors which are predictive of mortality in COVID-19 patients, These are longer time on hemodialysis, thrombocytopenia, higher lactate dehydrogenase level, higher C-reactive protein level and total leukocyte count, and also old age, comorbidities and severe COVID-19 infection. Just a comparison with other studies around the world, this is specifically to studies of ESRD. Various studies in USA, China, Turkey, France, Spain and our center, the mean age is comparable in all the study subjects. Our mean age was 60.7 and other places also the mean age was comparable. Also the chest X-ray findings, 60% of our patient had X-ray findings which were bilateral, which is comparable to other studies, and also the mortality we see was 27% for ESRD patients, which is comparable to the other places around the world. The mortality was 27% among ESRD patients on dialysis with COVID-19. It is similar to estimates from other centers in China, Europe and USA. And the mortality was 72% among COVID-19 patients who had acute kidney injury. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. You said your median ICU stay is 5 days.
Yes, sir.
Probably that may be the in the comparative chart with the world literature, probably that may be quite less. Do you have any reason for that apart from the high incidence of high mortality?
So this comparison that which we have done, it is only for ESRD patients, sir. And the ICU patients, most of these patients had AKI, sir. Almost all patients had AKI in ICU settings. This comparison that we have done with other studies is for ESRD, sir. Patients who are on dialysis already.
Okay. Any questions or comments from other faculty or residents?
Yeah, Kapil. Kapil?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Just I want to know what is the outcomes of the patients who are on AKI and CKD. You are showing that one. You are showing the AKI and CKD. That what is the outcomes in those patients?
These patients, AKI and CKD, same outcome. This 18 patients had AKI or AKI and CKD. Out of that 72 patients, 13 patients expired and 5 recovered.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Anybody has any other question? If no question, thank you very much for the nice presentation. It was a good experience.
Thank you, sir.
There are no more questions. We'll move on to the next presentation from the Department of Preventive and Social Medicine in collaboration with Microbiology. It's about SARS-CoV-2 infection in Puducherry. Findings from the Round 1 Zero Prevalence Survey. I call upon Dr. Sitanshu to start presenting.
Yeah, we can see the slides. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Biju and Dr. Mamta. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to present the project or the research titled SARS-CoV-2 Infection in Pondicherry, Findings from the Round 1 Seroprevalence Study. So this was conducted in collaboration with Microbiology Department, and we conducted this study during August 11 to 16. So as we know that India is the second worst hit countries in terms of country in terms of the number of cases of COVID, and Pondicherry in India per se is the second worst affected union territory with in the if you look at the number of cases reported in last 7 days, and the total the spectrum of disease for COVID-19 disease starts from severe, moderate, mild, and asymptomatic. I have put it in the other order because the severe and moderate cases are usually diagnosed in hospitals by the RT-PCR thing, and mild and asymptomatic cases are usually missed in the community because of various reasons. Lab confirmed cases form only a portion of the total infected. So there is, hence there is a need to estimate the level of SARS-CoV-2 infection in the population to get an idea how far the population is infected with SARS-CoV-2 infection, and when and it will also help us for planning and resource allocation. So the objective of the study is to determine the seroprevalence of SARS-CoV-2 infection among the adult population of more than 18 years of age in of Pondicherry district in the Union Territory of Pondicherry. There was a second objective as well, to monitor the trend of this infection, but in this presentation we'll limit ourselves to the first one. We conducted a population-based cross-sectional study among the adults of more than 18 years who are residing in the district of Pondicherry during August 11 to 16th this year. And we used a semi-structured questionnaire, and 2 ml blood was collected from the study participants after taking informed consent. The blood was analyzed for antibodies level in SARS-CoV-2 using immunoassay technique using the Roche diagnostic kit. The sample size was calculated based on the seroprevalence data of Delhi with exposed to diagnosed cases, taking the ratio of 50:1. We calculated that to be 12.2% for during 28th of July. And using a relative precision of 20% and design effect of 1.3, the total sample size was calculated to be 899. A multi-stage geographically clustered stratified random sampling, 30 into 30 clusters were conducted for this methodology with using the probability proportional to size sampling methodology with a replacement technique. So if you look at Pondicherry is divided into urban and rural areas. It is one of the highest urbanized area in the country, with 70% urban population and 30% rural population. 90 wards were there and 62 villages are present in the rural area. So keeping PPS sampling in mind, 21 wards and 9 villages were selected from these 2 areas respectively. In the urban area, we also had another sampling method where we selected randomly 21 census enumeration blocks. And from this 21 census enumeration block and 9 villages, 30 households were selected. These households were selected using systematic random technique, where the first household was selected randomly, and using the sampling interval, the subsequent households were enrolled into the study. After having identified the households, we selected one individual per household using the modified Kish table as recommended by the ICMR in their methodology paper of seroprevalence study, which was published in IJMR. And it depends upon the number of adult females in the household. If there is one single female present in the household, and there are 2 total number of household members, or 2 adults are there, then you have to just go like this and find out that the female should be included in the study. So this is how we selected some individuals into the study. If you look at this map, the red dots indicate urban areas, and the violet dots indicates the rural sites of data collection. This graph indicates how the data collection and the results are linked. If the point number A, point A indicates the duration, the period where the data collection was done between 11th to 16th of August. But the results are applicable for 24th of July, because that is 3 weeks prior to the data collection, as it takes antibodies take time to develop. So whatever we are presenting, the results will be applicable to 24th of July. The second round is now ongoing. Today was the first day of data collection in the field. So 5 trained teams, including 1 data collector and phlebotomist, after training went to the field. They obtained their informed written consent from the study participants. Sociodemographic and exposure history and a little bit of clinical history was also collected from them. 2 ml of venous blood was collected, and it was transported to Jipmer Virology Research Lab within 2 hours. Anti-SARS-CoV-2 immunoassay was carried out using Roche diagnostics with sensitivity of more than 95% and specificity of more than 95% at more than 14 days post-exposure. The statistical analysis, the seroprevalence was reported as percentages with 95% confidence interval. Infection case ratio was done to identify the gaps in testing and undetected cases. Data were entered and managed in EpiCollect version 5. Analysis was done in IBM SPSS version 22. And the main results are like as follows. The overall prevalence was found to be 4.9% with a confidence interval of 3.5 to 6.4%. The total number of samples tested were 869, which gives to a response rate of 97%. Because of the small sample size, there was no difference found between the number of reactive cases in different age groups. It ranged from 4.7% to 5.6%. We found women are having higher reactive percentage, 6.3 versus 3.6 against men. In urban area, it was 5.7%, and in rural, it was 3.1. One thing is we could encounter three people who were already diagnosed with COVID-19 during the survey, and they are all found to be reactive by the assay. So the total symptoms present during the last 6 months were reported by 9.4% cases. And if we look at, we identify the infected to diagnosed ratio, the seroprevalence of SARS-CoV-2 was found to be 4.9%, and the cumulative incidence reported on as of 24th July was calculated to be 0.19%, hence giving the ratio of 26:1. That means for each diagnosed cases, there are 26 infection in the community. So to conclude the study, 1 in 20 adults showed evidence of infection in Pondicherry. Infection is more in urban than and among women. And we are planning to do the second round, and the first day of data collection just started today. We'll come out with the trends subsequently. I think these are my references, and I'll stop here, and I'll take some questions if there are any. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I acknowledge the work done by the field staff in collecting the study and the data from the field, from all these 30 sites. It was really a challenging task to do it I really thank for their support. Thank you so much.
Yeah, we can invite questions from other faculty and the residents. Yeah, Dr. Sidhanshu, your findings of the seroprevalence study, what was our assumption before this study? Was it confirming or contradicting our assumption?
Yeah, the initial assumption which we started is we thought that we'll be at least getting, because if you see the sample size calculation was 12.2%, we took that. To my mind, I was thinking that we'll be getting some results around 15 to 20% seroprevalence, but we didn't get it. So probably because July, the cases have gone up from 1st of August onwards, probably in the second round, we'll get some more information about that. So it is very difficult to predict anything in this pandemic, the infection rate and other things. It's a very complex issue.
Okay. In fact, when the CTS increases a test, we are not getting the proportional increase of positivity. The positivity is drastically coming down, as you might be knowing. So it has something to do with our hypothesis or assumption with this study?
So the positivity depends upon the testing strategy we have. So whom we are testing, what happens is if we are testing the people who are positive and they're very close contacts, the household contacts, then definitely the infection will be there. But if we are expanding the base of testing the people who are the contacts of contacts, then overall the positivity will come down. That's how it has shown in other areas. So And it also the increasing the testing strategy will also have resource constraints. So how do you manage? So in some of the studies, like in US also, they say that we should test almost 5 to 7% of the total population to get the actual number. If you look at that per day, that is per day. So in that, if we go by that assumption, even if 10% of the population of Pondicherry is tested every day, it will be 1 lakh test. So it is quite difficult and resource intensive. And after detecting them, what are we going to do? That is another big question that we should answer. When the infection is asymptomatic and mild cases are more common, we have in Pondicherry, this is a very difficult scenario because the houses are quite close, overcrowded. So that's also an issue. So there are multiple problems are there for this particular thing.
Any questions from other faculty or residents?
Yeah, Sitanshu Kadiran here.
Yes.
I want to ask two questions. One is that the estimate of 4.9% is a simple average of 43 out of 816. But I understand that you had a multi-stage sampling. So would it be appropriate to have a weighted average here instead of a simple average?
Yes, we didn't do weighted average because the issue was the numbers were quite less. So we're planning to do it after the second round is over. So maybe I'll come back to this forum again after we do this weighted average for this each of this area. So we initially thought to do weighted average for as per the area and as per the age. You are right. We'll do that and we'll come back to this forum again.
Okay. The second question is more of a theoretical thing. We know for now, for reasonably sure, that the T cell response far exceeds the prevalence of seroprevalence. So given that observation, is it likely that actual population exposure to the virus is maybe anything higher than what we captured in the seroprevalence? What is your take on this?
I don't know exactly about that particular thing, but what I understand is the whatever we have got here is based on the assay. It also depends upon what we are trying to find out. This particular Roche thing is looking at the nucleocapsid particular thing. So there are other ELISA coverage and other things are there. We are looking at the whole viral genome. So the getting that, the proportion will be more. But I'm not sure about the T cell response and how that is less or more about it.
Yeah. Kadir, may I join issues with you? The first
yes,
one.
Yes.
So, you know, the whole population in Pondicherry is in 70:30 ratio. There were only two strata, urban, rural, and they were taken in the same 70:30 ratio. If you take a weighted average, you will kind of end up with the same ratio. Yes, you can say that different blocks had different sizes. What was done here was sampling proportional to size, okay? Sampling probability, PPA sampling probability proportional to size, when you do that, then you don't need to adjust for weightage because the need for that reduces. About antibody versus T cell. You know, doing a T cell thing in a large population is difficult. If you have a higher positivity, the question is, it may be more sensitive, is it more specific? And the data on specificity of T cell responses are relatively limited. And therein lies a problem. There were originally, the data suggested that antibodies don't persist possibly for long, but if you see the recent data in New England Journal of Medicine from Iceland, when they have followed people up to 4 months, it appears that antibodies last, not four, I think 3 months, antibodies last at least for that duration, and we are within that duration right now, so I don't think there is much of concern on that. But of course, what is the best, we don't know. if you do multiple tests, whether you take one positive as positive or whether you take all three positive as positive, one way you increase the sensitivity, other way you increase the specificity. It's a moot question. Thank you.
Thanks.
Any other question or comments from faculty or residents? Request Dr. Sitanshu to see the chat box, Axel, if there is any question. If not, we can go to the next presentation. We have two more short case reports. I request the presenters to stick on to 5 minutes each.
The case report to be presented next is COVID-19 related dermatosis, a report of two spectrum of manifestations in different age groups from the Department of Dermatology, Pediatrics and Cardiology. So I request the presenter to please load the presentation. Kindly load the presentation.
Excuse me, ma'am, can you see the slides?
Yeah, we can see that. Can you make it full screen?
Okay, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah, please.
Is it fine now?
Please go ahead.
Yeah, this is fine. Yeah. Please start.
Cutaneous manifestations of COVID-19 differ in children as well as in adults, akin to systemic manifestations. So today we'll see about two cases who were belonging to different age groups with different manifestations of COVID-19 related dermatosis. So urticaria, maculopapular rash or vesicular rash can be present in all ages. However, chilblains, erythema multiforme, cutaneous manifestations of multisystem syndrome in children temporarily associated with SARS-CoV-2 has been found predominantly in children. The morphological subtypes of the lesions vary with the timing of eruption and disease outcomes. So here in this report, we will see about two morphologically varied the disease course. So coming to case one, presented to pediatric emergency skin lesions from day 3 of fever, which remitted and bites. There was no history suggestive of angioedema. His past history, he had history of posterior urethral valve with recurrent urinary tract infection. So upon examination, his blood pressure was less than 50 centile, according to his anthropometry, and there were multiple veins with arcuates over the trunk.
Dr. Kirutika, there is some disturbance in your audio.
Diagnosis of acute.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Kirutika, there are some disturbances in your audio. Can you please?
Is it okay now, ma'am?
Yeah, it's fine. Please go ahead.
Differential diagnosis. Upon further probing, try it with my back. Then it was repeatedly tested, but he ate them. In a private hospital with complaints of fever, rash, hypotension, GI symbiotics, And as child developed shock, this was, so we investigated the child and which for albuminemia, his inflammatory markers like ESR and serum ferritin were also elevated. His acute febrile illness panel was negative, and run for SARS-CoV-2 was twice negative outside Jipmer also, which also turned to be negative. So as we had a possibility of incomplete Kawasaki disease, we proceeded with 2D echo as the coronary cusp is dilated with the diameter of 5 millimeter. Child was less than 21 years. He had fever.
Dr. Kirtika, can you hear us?
Your audio is not okay. Hello?
And the slides are not moving.
Hello?
Are there any issues with the network or something? Hello?
Can you hear from this end? Hello? Are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Now you please continue. Are you able to hear? Hello? Are you able to hear?
Yes, sir. Is it audible now?
No. Are you using your mobile for presentation?
Sir, actually, I had some difficulty in my laptop, sir. It is not working. That is why.
Now, you continue your presentation quickly and finish it.
Yeah, please continue. Move the slides, please.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. So coming to case two, there's a 14.
We are not able to hear your slides. We are not able to see your slides.
With SARS-CoV.
Yeah, please continue.
Can you hear?
No, we are not able to hear you. We are not. Please continue.
Yes, sir. Case two, we have a 49-year-old lady from Vilupuram who was diagnosed with SARS-CoV-2 infection during her first day of symptoms, sir. She reported pain over her right leg since 4 days, hampering physical activity. Past history was uneventful. Upon today's examination, she had solitary tender crusted ulcer with peripheral dusky erythematous halo and fringe of scaling, which was present over the gaiters area, measuring 1x1 cm. She had ankle flare, which was attributable to the varicose veins. However, she did not have any stasis-induced skin changes. She had no rash anywhere else in the body. The other limb was normal. Skin biopsy was not performed as she was COVID positive. And with the differential diagnosis of Leber-Hyde vasculopathy and Eschar, we investigated her. And her investigations showed normal D-dimer levels and normal platelet counts.
So during her disease course, she was started on azithromycin and aspirin, and her hospital stay was uneventful. She was discharged after 12 days, and upon follow-up, the lesions have recovered over a month's time. And venous Doppler for after a month showed incompetent subpinofemoral junction with multiple incompetent perforators in GSB and SSV territory. So here, microvascular occlusion presenting as levidoid vasculopathy could be unmasking of pre-existing chronic venous insufficiency, wherein the coagulopathy caused by the virus was precipitated on the limb with sluggish bed flow. So here she had a good outcome as there were no systemic coagulopathy. So COVID-19 dermatosis has been divided into inflammatory and vascular. In inflammatory, we have maculopapular eruptions, articularia, and vesicular lesions. In vascular, we have chilblain-like lesions and livido or necrotic lesions. The inflammatory lesions generally are benign and present during the acute manifestation of COVID. The vascular lesions can present both at acute and as a chronic manifestation. And the prognosis depends upon the presence or absence of systemic coagulopathy. So we have two mechanisms of pathogenesis, namely direct endothelial injury by cytopathic viral effect or cytokine storm leading to endothelial injury. So here in the first case, the cytokine storm and endothelial injury resulted in inflammatory cutaneous manifestation, namely articaria, and vascular sequelae, namely coronary artery dilatation. In the second case, microvascular thrombosis due to endothelial injury resulted in vascular symptom of levidoid vasculopathy. So our study highlights that COVID-related dermatosis vary with regards to onset during the disease course, age, and prognosis. And documentation of COVID-19-related dermatosis is important because it has significant implication in the prognosis of the patient. Thank you.
Yeah, because of the lack of time, we will not allow any questions for this. And further, please don't present from mobile. It is not supported. We'll go to the last presentation.
Yeah. The last presentation for today's meeting will be from the Department of CTVS and Anesthesiology and Critical Care. It's a case report of ECMO for a critically ill COVID-19 infected patient. Lessons learned from the first case at Jipmer. I call upon Dr. Hemachandran to start presenting.
Yeah, please go ahead. We can see your slides. Are you able to hear?
Yes, sir. I'm able to hear, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, all. My report is on ECMO for critically ill COVID-19 infected patient, lessons learned from the first case at Jipmer. As we all know, ECMO is recommended therapy for ARDS patients, but during outbreaks of infectious diseases, it's quite challenging owing to the increased number of cases. In COVID-19, despite invasive mechanical ventilation, refractory hypoxemia is common among the critically ill with ARDS. Hence, the CTVS surgeons and the anesthetists and intensivists are compelled to make a decision to put the patient on ECMO, as these patients are needed to be treated and even with limited scientific evidence. However, this ECMO is associated with a deleterious outcome because it itself can initiate a systemic inflammatory response and lymphopenia and increased interleukin-6 levels, which are inversely correlated with survival. But WHO and NIH recommend use of ECMO as rescue therapy for refractory hypoxemic patients. Our case is a 68-year-old male who presented with SARI symptoms since 1 week. He was morbidly obese with a BMI of 42.5 kgs per meter square. On day one, he presented with a saturation of 93%. He was tachypneic with abdominal distension, and he was put on NIV and supported with FiO2 of 80% and PEEP of 15. But immediately on day two, he worsened further and he was mechanically ventilated, put on SAMV mode with FiO2 of 70% and PEEP of 7. His saturation was maintained to 98%, but still he was tachypneic. Gradually on day 3, 4, and 5, his PO2 levels further dropped and his FiO2 levels we have to increase to 100% with PEEP of 10. Even then, the PO2 was only 58 and he was hemodynamically unstable and he has to be supported on double inotropes with vasopressors, noradrenaline, and vasopressin. His platelet count was 62,000 and there was lymphopenia and D-dimers levels also were in higher level. On day 6, his PO2 further dropped to 37.7 millimeters of mercury and hence a decision was taken to initiate the patient on VA ECMO. VA ECMO, we mean veno arterial ECMO, wherein a femoral circuit was placed for this patient. The drainage cannula was kept in the inferior vena cava through the femoral vein. It's connected to the centrifugal pump. It pumps the blood into the membranous oxygenator, which oxygenates the blood and pumps the blood back into the descending thoracic aorta through the return cannula, which is placed in the femoral artery. And a reperfusion cannula was placed distally so that the limb doesn't go in for any ischemia. An X-ray has to be X-ray was taken after putting the patient on ECMO, and the cannula was and the position of the cannula has to be ascertained to be in the right atrium. And here you can see the cannula at the right atrial SVC junction. So after placing the patient on VA ECMO, the PO2 immediately improved to 107 and the patient was becoming hemodynamically stable. His vasopressor requirements came down and his lactate levels came down to 3 and the FiO2 levels in the ventilator came down to 40%. But the patient further worsened. He started developing renal shutdown with a rising creatinine level of 2.8. He was having severe anemia and severe thrombocytopenia and has to be supported on with blood products. And then the CRRT was initiated, connected to the pump to the ECMO circuit, and ultrafiltrate was maintained at 50 ml per hour. Further, the patient worsened, as you can see in the X-ray, with the bilateral whitish patch opacities, and PO2 fell down to 42. In spite of supporting the patient with VA ECMO of 100% and FiO2 of 100%, why his PO2 levels dropped is due because of the north-south syndrome. There occurs more of oxygenated blood pumped by the heart, and the upper part of the body receives fully deoxygenated blood as shown by a PO2 of 32, and the lower part of the blood body gets blood from the VA ECMO circuit and oxygenated blood. This can be avoided by converting the VA circuit into a VAV ECMO circuit, wherein the inflow another inflow cannula is placed at the level of superior vena cava and oxygenated blood is taken as a wide limb from the return cannula into the femoral artery, and so that oxygenated blood reaches the upper part of the body as well, and this differential oxygenation is avoided and brain is perfused with good PO2 blood. So after placing the patient on VAV ECMO, the PO2 raised to 200 and 300, but the patient finally succumbed in spite of triple vasopressors because of underlying sepsis and multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. Based on the current medical evidence and outcomes, it is not appropriate to state a patient that as ECMO will never be considered for COVID-19 patients. ECMO should be initiated quickly before the refractory hypoxemia leads to multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. And a case-by-case decision has to be taken and it has to be reassessed on periodical basis regularly because of the overall patient load, staffing problems and other resource constraints, and also the way hospital policies. A stringent criteria for patient selection in resource poor settings is mandatory. This is the initial series from China, wherein the mortality rates were almost shown to be 100%, 83%, but later the studies from ELS Euro ECMO survey showed that almost 515 patients who were put on ECMO supported both suspected and confirmed COVID-19 cases. The ECMO was initiated 3 to 4 days after patient is mechanically ventilated, and VAV ECMO was the preferred mode of circuit, and the median ECMO duration was approximately 8 days. The mortality rate was reduced down to 41% as opposed to the Chinese studies. This is a study from France wherein 12 patients were put on ECMO, out of which 8 patients were successfully discharged home and only 4 patients succumbed finally even after putting the patient on ECMO, reducing the mortality rate to almost 33%. This is the ELSO 2019 interim guidelines showing the indications for putting the patient on ECMO. PaO2 or FiO2 ratio of less than 60 for more than 6 hours, or a ratio of less than 50 millimeters of mercury for more than 3 hours, with a PaSO2 of more than 80 with respiratory acidosis, are all the three most important factors to be considered to place a patient on ECMO. This slide shows the various absolute and relative contraindications for putting the patient on ECMO based on the same ELSO guidelines. Advanced age more than 70 years, multiple comorbidities, uncontrolled diabetes, disseminated malignancy, and various hemorrhagic diathesis are all absolute contraindications. And coming to relative contraindications, obesity with a BMI of more than or equal to 40 is also a relative contraindication. And high dose vasopressor requirement, as these two that our patient had. But if you are considering for a VE ECMO, high dose vasopressor requirement, we can need not take it as a contraindication. But when you are placing a VV ECMO, it's an absolute contraindication if the patient is on high vasopressor support. So finally, from our case, we could appreciate that there was a good teamwork with between cardiac surgeons, anesthetist, intensivist, and nephrologist, and there was good communication while taking care of the patient. Adequate personnel were deployed, and the healthcare worker safety was ascertained 24/7 by continuous supply of PPE, and there was good blood bank support with all blood products available round the clock. But there were some lessons learned. There was some delay in decision making as the patient was put on VA ECMO after the patient became hemodynamically unstable, which could have been very well considered when the patient was hemodynamically stable and patient was in MRSA sepsis and patient was morbidly obese, which was a relative contraindication by ALSO study interim guidelines. And VA ECMO is considered to be having a poorer outcome when considered to when compared to VV ECMO. And if laboratory estimates of IL-6 levels are available, it could be helpful in prognosticating the patient while managing the patient on ECMO. So there are various challenges when the ECMO program is started at an institutional level. The expected benefit of therapy versus the possible risks, the scientific evidence is not yet so clear. And regarding the availability of ECMO supplies, lots of monetary issues involved for getting the ECMO, because when a patient is put on ECMO, almost around 2 lakhs are spent every day. And the hospital infrastructure, the interdisciplinary collaborations with training of healthcare personnel has to be ascertained while running a healthcare program, ECMO program, and healthcare worker safety is also has to be considered, which will be a major challenge when you're starting the ECMO program at the institutional level. So to conclude, the early decision, appropriate selection of the patient and teamwork are the key factors for successful outcome with ECMO in COVID-19. However, mismatches are anticipated owing to high caseload, a scarce resource in times of hypertension is anticipated, and so an action plan with a sustainable system to ensure quality of care is very much necessary. There is ethical dilemma of patient selection as to which patient has to be prioritized on ECMO, but nonetheless, the opportunity of saving even a relatively small number of patients in comparison to the large loss of lives produced by this highly lethal disease cannot be ignored. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Emma, for the nice presentation. And I hope the high BMI mentioned as 42.5
yes, sir,
has contributed significantly to the mortality of this patient.
Yes, sir.
And I just have a question. Worldwide, what is the incidence of bacterial sepsis in patients who underwent ECMO? Is it 100%?
Not 100%, sir. It's not mandatory that if the patient is well maintained in ICU with all precautionary measures, it's not that bacterial sepsis is mandatory in a patient in ECMO.
Okay. And second question is, what are the challenges you connect CRRT also along with the ECMO?
It has to be connected to the arterial limb of the ECMO. First thing is, the if the patient goes in for the, if it's connected to the arterial limb, if the CRRT is connected, there is a risk of sepsis is there if the CRRT is connected. And the CRRT machine has a rotor flow. It's a rotor pump, whereas the ECMO machine is a centrifugal pump. There can be some discrepancy when a centrifugal pump is connected to a rotor pump.
Yeah, the question was related to the last point, centrifugal versus a rotor pump.
Rotor pump.
So that will create some challenges, am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Any other questions from faculty or residents?
Hey, Mr. Chandran, Kadiran here. I just wanted to know, is there a learning curve for ECMO?
No, sir. Actually, this is part of the cannulation strategies we routinely follow during our heart-lung machine. So we have a dedicated perfusionist team who very well manage the patients on heart-lung machine. So they can also manage the patients on ECMO. So as such, when you consider learning curve, there is no learning curve, sir, involved for ECMO.
Okay.
The only thing, the team as such, including the intensivist and the nursing personnel, should be aware of the ECMO strategies. If the there is good teamwork, then the success, the outcome is better.
Okay.
May I agree with Dr. Hema Chandran, because it's a teamwork actually.
the resident who is managing, the surgeon, the intensivist, and nurses, whole team actually. It's not about putting cannula and running the pump, maintaining that nutrition, physiotherapy, all other things, taking care of the infection. It's a continuous process and it's a longer process. It's not a short one also.
Dr. Kathiravan, I'm so happy you brought that thing up about the learning curve.
Satyan, please.
I think the ELSO does put a learning curve on centers which are starting off doing ECMO. So typically they would put it as around 30 successful ECMO runs for them to produce standardized results, which could be compared with other centers in other parts of the world. So I do think there is a definite learning curve to doing this. And I think we are just at the bottom of that curve. We are just starting out.
Thank you. Thank you, Satya.
Any questions from faculty or residents? We'll wait for 30 seconds more for any more questions.
There was a question in the chat box, sir. That how does IL-6 estimation changes our treatment?
Yeah, please answer. Go ahead.
It helps to prognosticate the patient. The falling IL-6 levels will tell us that we are going in the right direction. So it's not to, as such, it influences the treatment. It helps in prognosticating the patient.
If there are no further questions, we'll wind up the session on today's session. And from the JSS side, we wanted to inform all the presenters that the abstracts you have sent will be published as a special bulletin by JSS, because we have some important information which will be useful for patient management are coming out of your abstracts. So it will be published in another 2 to 3 days. And once again, we thank all the departments, all the under the departments, all the presenters for the scientific contribution to our JIPMER efforts for fighting COVID. Thank you very much once again, and we'll close this session.